Minister of National Defense, Chiefs of Defense, Strategic Commanders, Military Representatives, Distinguished Guests, Ladies and Gentlemen, j'ai l'honneur de vous souhaiter la bienvenue à la conférence du comité militaire ici à Athens. We are here at the invitation of the Greek government, the Ministry of Defense, and the General Staff. Mr. Panagiotopoulos, General Floros, on behalf of the committee, I want to thank both of you for the warm welcome and hospitality you have shown us since our arrival. With the continued impact of the COVID-19 virus and the devastating wildfires that hit Greece over the summer, this conference comes at a challenging time. Nevertheless, the organization of this conference has been flawless. This is one of the many examples of how Greece proves to be a resilient nation and a valued NATO ally. Ever since Greece joined the alliance in 1952, it has contributed to our main mission, the protection and defense of allied citizens and territory. Your resilience is highly valued, especially given the current challenges that are facing the alliance. The rules-based international order is being undermined by authoritarian powers. Russia continues its pattern of aggressive behavior. China is challenging accepted norms of international relations. Terrorism threatens the safety of our citizens. New technologies are changing the nature of conflict. Hybrid warfare, including disinformation, is on the rise. Cyber attacks are becoming more frequent and more disrupting. And climate change is fueling conflict and exacerbating threats. In an unpredictable world, we need transatlantic unity and security. We need Europe and North America to stand strong, bound together by shared history, values, and goals. Throughout 2021, our allied forces have demonstrated determination and strength. They have assisted civil authorities in response to the pandemic, wildfires, and floods. They have worked, trained, and exercised alongside each other on NATO-led operations, missions, and activities across all domains in all types of environments. 2021 was the year that saw the end of our military presence in Afghanistan. Our servicemen and women served there for 2 decades, doing what their democratic governments asked of them, fulfilling the role that was enshrined in our constitutions. Never once have they failed to show us what true courage and commitment looks like. On behalf of the Military Committee, I want to thank the 3.2 million men and women who serve our alliance for their dedication, professionalism, and sacrifice. I would like to now take a moment to remember the sacrifice of those men and women killed or wounded in the line of duty. Their sacrifice will not be forgotten. Please stand. Speaking of dedication and professionalism, I'm pleased today to welcome 2 new members to the Military Committee. General Thierry Burkard from France. C'est avec grand plaisir que je vous souhaite la bienvenue. And Lieutenant General Romulus Rusin Zendi from Hungary. Welcome. I look forward to hearing your contributions and advice as the alliance continues to adapt while reinforcing its deterrence and defense posture. Our sessions today will begin by focusing on the ongoing missions and activities of the alliance, from Iraq to Kosovo, to our standing naval forces and air policing missions. We will discuss the progress of our strategic adaptation and review the implementation of our concept of deterrence and defense of the Euro-Atlantic area and NATO's warfighting capstone concept. In our next session, the committee will undertake a considered analysis into peacetime challenges and the enduring threats facing the alliance. There is an ancient Greek saying by Antisthenes, a pupil of Socrates, that I think we can all take to heart. He said that you should always pay attention to your enemies, for they are the first to discover your mistakes. After this session, we will look to the future by discussing the military implications and opportunities of the NATO 2030 agenda. A strong military, combined with the will to use it when necessary, is the essence of NATO's deterrence. And military force is the ultimate guarantor of allied freedom, as the Secretary General has recently reiterated. Without a strong and credible military to back it up, diplomacy will fail. And while military action is always the last resort, sometimes it is the only rational response. We will conclude our sessions with the election of the next Director General of the International Military Staff, better known as DGIMS. DGIMS is the head of the IMS, a staff of approximately 500 military and civilian personnel, who provide strategic and military advice and staff support for our committee. So we are all very much looking forward to find out who will fulfill this crucial position as of the summer of 2022. But now, I would first like to hand the floor over to General Floros for his opening remarks. Konstantinos, the floor is yours.
Your Excellency, Minister of Defense, dear colleagues, it is with great pleasure and honor that I'm hosting the 2021 Military Committees Conference. My acceleration is enhanced by the fact that we host the conference this year, which marks the bicentennial of my country's war of independence. It is my privilege to host all our allies in Athens for such an important event. Thank you all for being here in Athens, and thank you all for attending the opening ceremony last night at the Hellenic Naval Academy. I certainly hope that your expectations are being met. Now, being here today, all 30 NATO's Chief of Defense with the Chair of the Military Committee, Sakir and Sakt, is a unique opportunity to provide direction and guidance on the ongoing work stance in the Military Committee and support the decisions of the upcoming ministerial meetings. We all understand that the decisions of the June Brussels Summit, including those of NATO 2030 and the revision of the Alliance's strategic concept, set the stage for the implementation of a robust adaptation package in terms of political consultations, deterrence and defense, resilience, maintenance of our technological edge, partnerships, and even an ambitious approach to the effects of climate change. It is more than evident that most of these lines of work require our full attention and involvement. While the concept on the deterrence and defense of the Euro-Atlantic area, the strategic plan concerning SACEUR's area of responsibility, the NATO military strategy, the NATO warfighting capstone concept, and the warfare development agenda are major steps of the alliance's military adaptation, the military committee and the strategic commanders will no doubt be called to provide their unfettered advice concerning most of the new objectives agreed on the highest political level. There is consensus in NATO that we need to respond to challenges at the speed of relevance. The developments in Afghanistan have highlighted how important it is for the alliance to be able to reach decisions very fast and adapt to an emergent situation. We need to remain vigilant on this front. Another good example is the speed the military committee and SACEUR reacted when they were tasked by the Council to launch the Aegean activity in March 2020. 16, the Aegean activities signaled NATO's determination to contribute to the efforts of managing the immigration crisis. This was a validation of NATO's resolve and relevance and its ability to understand and respond to events outside the anticipated deterrence and defense pool of threats and challenges. Greece and her armed forces firmly stand as a major pillar for security and cooperation in Eastern Mediterranean in the current volatile environment, always respecting the good neighborly relations, the stipulations of the international law, and always building bridges that bring nations to cooperate together for the common benefit of stability. As a credible ally, we will continue to respect our obligations and honor our commitments. The Hellenic Armed Forces will keep contributing to the strengthening of NATO's readiness and responsiveness to security challenges in a credible and efficient manner. Moreover, we will continue engaging our comprehensive and constructive cooperation with important partners in our wider periphery, which I trust is serving NATO's interests as well. Dear colleagues, it is a great pleasure to have you all here in Athens. What we are seeing and experiencing is the outcome of hard work and dedication to preparing this whole project for more than a year and a half. I need to especially thank the chair of the military committee for all his support in organizing the event, and of course, all the international military staff. Again, it is a pleasure and an honor to be your host. Thank you all for being here with us.
Thank you very much, Konstantinos. I now hand the floor to the Minister of Defense, Mr. Nikolaos Panagiotopoulos. Minister, the floor is yours.
Your Excellencies, Chair of the Military Committee, Chiefs of Defense, Strategic Commanders, Military Representatives, Distinguished Guests, Ladies and Gentlemen, good morning, bonjour. Allow me first to wish you a successful and productive deliberations for the 2021 Military Committee Conference. I will try to make it as short as possible in order to then move out and let you get the discussion underway. Yesterday I shared with you some thoughts about our alliance and its key role in promoting democratic values as well as facing together constantly evolving threats in an unstable and turbulent international environment. Today I'd like to put forward some ideas concerning the present and most importantly the future of our alliance. First, following recent developments in Afghanistan, I should underline the importance we attach to the efforts of the international community, which must work closely together to avoid a resurgence of terrorism in Afghanistan and beyond. We also need to ensure the safety and security of vulnerable Afghans, as well as the prevention of a humanitarian crisis. This is our moral duty, to help the Afghan people and provide as much support as possible, especially to those at immediate risk. We're going through a period of significant challenges in Afghanistan, including a risk of migration flows toward Europe. We need to effectively cooperate in order to provide support to those countries in the immediate neighborhood and thus avoid a migration crisis in our borders. What happened in Afghanistan should clearly help us draw useful lessons for the future and strengthen our joint sense of purpose in defending our common values and ideas. NATO must stay capable of dealing with any potential threats emanating from any direction. This is why a clear roadmap to the future of the alliance has been defined with the NATO 2030 process. Enhancing our resilience is a basic dimension of this process, an important aspect in the effort of building up improved defense capabilities for the future. While resilience is a national responsibility, it certainly reflects on the survivability and the overall war-fighting capability of NATO as a collective entity. Hence, it's considered that common standards concerning resilience should be adopted, the same objectives should be aimed for and pursued. There is evidently an added value in our alliance becoming a platform of allies sharing best practices on designing their own tailor-made national plans and procedures. Another essential factor of vital importance to the future of the alliance is, of course, technology. In the past, our technological advantage has largely determined to our benefit the outcome of conflicts, in which we were engaged. This particular advantage must surely be preserved. Moreover, I strongly believe that our assets should consist of interoperable technological platforms permitting their integration into a common command and control structure. In our effort to force the future of our alliance, military training is considered to be of the utmost importance. Common training actions bring together personnel from different member states, thus enabling for much better communication, whilst also building up a well-desired mutual understanding. This approach can certainly help bridge any existing gaps in perceptions, allowing for effective interoperability. Furthermore, joint exercises constitute an opportunity, as well as the motive for the development of new tactics, techniques, and procedures. And of course, it's essential that any training activities cover the whole spectrum of forces, capabilities, and entities, from the strategic level down to the tactical one. On climate change now, I think we all agree that this is the defining challenge of our time. It affects our daily lives, our future, but also our security. We support the idea that NATO should become the leading international organization in analyzing how it affects security in order to understand and adapt to its impact. And one more thing we all realize, the climate change crisis is an enemy common to all our societies. And let me add, it's an enemy that has already initiated hostilities against us. It's a clear and present danger, not a vague notion somewhere in the future. So we have to deal with it. Talking about the future of NATO, we should not forget the importance of our partners' substantial contribution to our missions and operations. Over time, they've shared our values and interests to safeguard the rules-based international order and suffered losses along our forces. Overall, it is an absolute necessity for NATO to enhance its cooperation with any friendly international players. In doing so, it would actually increase its own capacity. I believe that amongst our partners, a predominant position belongs to the European Union. The European Union is by no means a competitor of NATO. On the contrary, it's an indispensable partner adding up to the alliance's broader defense and security capability, reinforcing NATO. Therefore, we support a strong, closer, synergetic, mutually beneficial relation between NATO and the Union, in accordance with the two joint declarations, which constitute the framework of our cooperation and the principles of inclusiveness, reciprocity, and the respect of decision-making autonomy of both organizations. Let me conclude with one last thought. It is my strong belief that today as ever, our most important asset, the one that will lead us to prevalence over any potential adversary, if need arises, is none other than the women and men in service, the people you command, the personnel that you lead. They constitute the formidable human capital of our nations and our great alliance. I therefore urge you to make the best for them in order for them to become the best together. Distinguished guests, Greece is a stable, credible, and reliable ally in the region. We always support the cohesion and the unity of the alliance, as well as stability and security in the Eastern Mediterranean, the Balkans, and beyond, ready to assume our original role. We strive to build strong alliances with countries of the broader region which share the same vision and values based on the rules of international law and the principle of good neighborly relations. We will intensify our efforts in that respect. As Prime Minister Kyriakos Mitsotakis said last June on the occasion of NATO summit in Brussels, Greece is a pillar of stability in the Eastern Med. It's a country that even during the difficult times of the economic crisis steadily spent over 2% of its GDP on defense expenditures. Today, Greece invests increased resources in its military capabilities so that it can be even more reliable in its obligation vis-a-vis the alliance. May I add that we never strive to be antagonistic, we only strive to be diligent partners and allies. So I wish you every success in this important conference, which I'm convinced will provide very important conclusions and inspiring perspectives for the future of the alliance. Enjoy the rest of your stay in Athens. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Panagiotopoulos, for your important and inspiring words. We will now hear a video address by the Prime Minister, Mr. Mistokakis.
Chair of the Military Committee, Chiefs of Defense of NATO Member States, Supreme Allied Commander Europe, Supreme Allied Commander Transformation, military representatives of the Member States in NATO. It is with great pleasure that I welcome you all to Athens for the 2021 Military Committee's conference. I was not able to join you in person at the Hellenic Naval Academy last night for the opening ceremony, which I'm told was very successful. But as you know, I was hosting the EU-MED summit. Let me begin by offering our host, General Konstantinos Floros, a vote of thanks. I'm aware of his efforts to make today's event a real success. Ladies and gentlemen, your presence in Greece this year coincides with the celebration of the bicentennial of our War of Independence, a struggle that resulted in the establishment of the modern Greek state. Throughout our history, we have always valued alliances. Since 1952, NATO has been at the heart of Greece's defense and security architecture. The transatlantic bond that united us nearly 70 years ago is still binding us together in defending our collective security interests and values for a free, democratic, and safe Euro-Atlantic area. After all, NATO's strength rests in its values and principles: unity, solidarity, and respect for democracy and the rule of law. Today, the global security environment is evolving at speed in frequently unpredictable ways. This is challenging the strategic stability we have gained over recent decades. The situation in Afghanistan is a case in point, but it is not the only challenge. Dear guests, 2021 marks the beginning of a new cycle of NATO's adaptation, and the NATO 2030 agenda sets the tone for that adaptation. As we begin the implementation of this new adaptation process, we look forward to receiving your advice and recommendations based on your expertise and professionalism. Greece remains a strong and reliable partner in the alliance endeavors. In support of the Defense Investment Pledge and NATO security interests in the Balkans and the Eastern Mediterranean, as well as NATO's missions, operations, and activities. We have also forged partnerships which benefit NATO's security interests. They represent new opportunities for collaboration, connecting the dots and opening dialogue across the Eastern Mediterranean, North Africa, and the Middle East. The challenges and threats ahead for all of us are so complex that no country alone could effectively address them. Cooperation between us all is essential, and cooperation continues to define our alliance. Once again, I welcome you to Athens and wish you every success in your collective efforts. Thank you.
Mr. Panagiotopoulos, please convey our thanks to your Prime Minister for providing us with these inspiring remarks. Finally, we are supported today by our two strategic commanders, General Todd Walters, the Supreme Allied Commander Europe, and General André Lenata, Supreme Allied Commander Transformation. Regrettably, this is General Lenata's last meeting with his SECT as he ends his tenure later this month. During the afternoon session, we will say goodbye to him, as well as General Enzo Vecchiarelli from Italy and General Nick Carter from the United Kingdom. Last but not least, we should recognize the anniversary of our colleague from Turkey, Yasar Güler, who turned 21 today. But now, let us focus on the tasks at hand and make good use of our time together here in Athens. At the end of today's conference, I will convey the advice and guidance of the 30 Allied Chiefs of Defense in a letter to the Secretary General, and early next week, I will brief the North Atlantic Council on the outcome of this MCC. Konstantinos and I will now escort the minister, allowing him to leave. And I would now like to ask in the break the media to depart this opening session so we can begin later today's deliberations. Thank you.